You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Afghanistan, where the incumbent President Ashraf Ghani has been declared winner of 2019 presidential polls. The Independent Election Commission declared that Ghani won a little over 50% vote to secure his second consecutive term. But his principal political rival, Abdullah Abdullah, has rejected the verdict, calling it an election robbery and a coup against democracy. A report.
Almost 5 months after the scheduled polls and a war of accusations and counter-accusations from all political sides, the Independent Election Commission of Afghanistan declared Ashraf Ghani as the winner of the presidential polls held in September 2019. Ghani crossed the threshold of 50% by few votes to avoid the second round of polling between the top two, securing another term for himself. The IEC had earlier announced preliminary results in December, which saw Ghani win re-election by a slim margin, but Chief Executive Abdullah Abdullah dismissed the result as fraudulent and called for a full review. Ghani dedicated the victory speech to the people of Afghanistan and called for peace across the country.
Man piruzi ra piruzi mardum ra baraye mardum tabrik megoyam wa min hayse khadim awwalin kishwar ba team muttahid ma لحظه به لحظه دقیقه به دقیقه از حقوق حقی مردم افغانستان دفاع کرد موږ سوله غواړو تل پایه سوله غواړو د وطن غوښتنه ده او دا تیم به انشاءالله تعالی ټول افغانستان ته سوله راوړي
Results, however, have recreated the situation of 2014, where a political impasse cropped up following no side conceding defeat. Abdullah Abdullah has outrightly rejected the results, saying they were fraudulent. Speaking to his supporters in Kabul, Abdullah described the results announced by the IEC as illegal and a coup against democracy. He said he would form an inclusive government with his allies.
نتیجه را که امروز اعلان کردند که نتیجه دزدی انتخابات، کودتا بر مردم سالاری، خیانت به اراده مردم و تمثیل اراده مردم بود، از اساس، از ریشه و از بنیاد این نتیجه را غیر قانونی می دانیم. ثبات و همگرایی به اساس آرای شفاف و بایومتریک شده پیروز این انتخابات است و ما پیروزی خود را اعلان میکنیم.
In 2014, the United States had brokered a peculiar power-sharing agreement that made Ashraf Ghani the president and Abdullah Abdullah the chief executive of the country. The relationship has since been marred by distrust and a jostling for power in Kabul. It seems that Afghanistan is heading towards a complex political situation. The Taliban and the United States too have decided to go ahead with the deal, and a reduction in violence or RIV will be the first step. The US has assured that agreement would be announced following the observation of the RIV phase. The agreement will not be a reprieve for the country, as both the US and Kabul wants intra-Afghan dialogue which the Taliban have refused since the beginning of the talks.
Moving on. While a huge political crisis is looming for Afghans inside their territory, the future of millions others who have been living a life of refugee hangs in balance. Neither they have been granted the citizenship by other countries, nor they are being allowed to practice any profession. Pakistan, which homes the largest number of them, has not done anything at ground level, but has not spared even one chance to pat its own back at the international forum. It organized one such event in its capital, Islamabad, to earn more international brownie points.
Homeless Afghan refugees are one of the most persecuted people on earth, who have nowhere to go when the host nation decides to repatriate them. The home conditions that escaped for a shade still prevail, and the prospects of peace deal are still uncertain. Pakistan has been subtly pushing for their repatriation under the garb of returning peace in Afghanistan. The country has secured a positive reputation for merely allowing them to stay in their country for a certain period of time and now wants to push them back to their country. These refugees were neither given the status of citizen nor were they allowed to practice profession owing to absence of citizenship.
I want to reaffirm that the preferred durable solution for refugees has always been voluntary repatriation in safety and dignity to their country of origin. And this is also true for Afghan refugees. Through its support to the ongoing peace efforts and building the necessary regional consensus, Pakistan continues to play a crucial role in realizing this potentially historic opportunity for peace. And the United Nations remains committed to supporting an inclusive and Afghan-led peace process that upholds the human rights of all citizens and leads to a sustainable peace in Afghanistan.
Afghans began fleeing their homeland soon after the pro-Soviet coup in April 1978, and most of them settled in Pakistan. According to United Nations statistics, there are 5 million Afghan refugees in Pakistan, Iran, and elsewhere. Approximately one-third of Afghanistan's pre-war population of 15 million has been uprooted and scattered. They represent one-half of the world's estimated refugee population. Around 400,000 people were repatriated in 2016. A total of 380,884 Afghan refugees left Pakistan for Afghanistan in 2016. Pakistan, which has been lately been focusing more at public relations than the actual work on ground, hosted the conference titled 40 Years of Afghan Refugees in Islamabad. Prime Minister Imran Khan reiterated Islamabad's propaganda, saying that his country was defending the human rights and the dignity of the Afghan people.
Whole country is on the same page. Our security forces are on the same page. Normally, there was an idea that the security forces in Pakistan had their own policy and the government a different one. This is not the case in Pakistan anymore. Whatever the situation might have been in the past, right now I can tell you, all of us, there's one thing we want is peace in Afghanistan. It's not just because we have 1.4 million registered refugees. We are the second country in the world with the second biggest refugee population. And for 22 years, we were the number one country with the biggest refugee population. It's not because of that, because the people of Afghanistan deserve peace. That's the most important thing.
40 years ago, Afghans began fleeing the violence in their country and sought refuge across nearby borders. but they were not received well. They have been forcibly returned in large numbers from Europe, Iran, and Pakistan. They were even subjected to cruel conditions by these countries. Many commentators believe that international organizations have been wrong and unprofessional in their assessment when they call their lives improved. Former UN Special Rapporteur on the human rights of internally displaced persons had even said that sending the refugees back will only add to the instability in Afghanistan.
Moving on, Kashmiri activists have rejected the bombastic rhetoric of Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, in which he spewed Islamabad-manufactured anti-India venom to secure Kashmiri people's confidence. A Kashmiri leader condemned Erdogan for even talking about human rights, for Erdogan himself was an agent slaughter of civil rights and a brutal suppressor of dissent. Kashmiris have also accused Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan of spinning propaganda on Kashmir to mislead the international community. A report.
Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan read out a long, monotonous script in front of a joint session of the Pakistani Parliament. Each word and sentence was, of course, written in Pakistani Prime Minister's office. It sounded like a political hate speech aiming to appease one particular section. Erdogan, who has been deemed human rights violator by several media houses and forums across the world, tried to paint the prosperous region of Jammu and Kashmir as a region deprived of fundamental rights. An Islamic undertone was his idea of garnering support, but Kashmiris, who have been suffering under Pakistani occupation for more than 7 decades, rejected all his propositions, saying he was not thinking about Kashmiris' welfare, but his empire.
Two Kashmiri, a human rights defenders, and Kashmir cause ko dekhte hue, ye dekhna padega. कि इससे क्या कश्मीरियों को कोई फायदा मिलेगा वेयरहैज के तुर्की के अंदर खुद इंसानी हकूक की खिलाफ वर्जियाँ उस बड़े पैमाने पे हो रही हैं कि जिसमें पूरी दुनिया का जो मीडिया और इंसानी हकूक की तंजीमें जिन्होंने रिपोर्ट कंपाइल की हैं कि तकरीबन 33,000 सियासी कारकुन और ख़ास करके पोलिटिकल अपोनेंट्स जो हैं वो तुर्की में कैद हैं गुज़श्ता 1.5-2 सालों से
The speech of Erdogan doesn't come across as a surprise, for he has supported Pakistan on several occasions for its wrongdoings. Despite Pakistan's consistent support to the expansion of terrorism, his country has opposed Islamabad's blacklisting by terror financing watchdog FATF. Experts across the forum, however, believe that it is not just Pakistan, but Erdogan's agenda is larger and more devious. He aspires to rule the world, and securing the crown of the Muslim world is his first objective. But he hasn't been successful so far because of Saudi Arabia and its allies. Pakistan owes a huge debt to Riyadh, but has lately been hugely inspired by Ankara. The partnership is growing multi-dimensional. Pakistan's support in return will grow Turkey stronger and more influential in the Middle East. Erdogan's pro-Pakistan and anti-India speech was followed by these bilateral prospects. New Delhi has condemned it squarely, saying Turkish president had no historical reference behind his statements and he was deficient of the facts while making speech in front of Pakistan's joint parliamentary session. It has also asked Ankara to refrain interfering in India's internal issues, for it will have bearings on the bilateral relations between the two countries.
Kashmiri activists on the other side said Turkish president had no right to speak over Kashmir as Erdogan himself was flag bearer of fundamentalism.
Syria ki tabahi aur barbadi ke andar Turki jo jis tarah ka kirdar ada kar raha hai aur fundamentalism ko farog de raha hai to main samajhta hu ki samajhdar aur durandesh kashmiriyon ko samajhna chahiye ki Turki ki حمایت کشمیریوں کے لیے کسی قسم کی کوئی مدد نہیں فراہم کر سکتی کیونکہ ترکی خود انسانی حقوق کی جس بڑے پیمانے پہ خلاف ورزی کر رہا ہے کہ ترکی کے اندر لوگوں کو ڈیمونسٹریشنز کرنے کی اجازت نہیں ہے
کشمیری ایکٹیوسٹ ایون ریڈیکیولڈ پاکستان پرائم منسٹر عمران خان فار لیکنگ نالج آف ہسٹری اینڈ پالیٹکس
یہ نہیں معلوم کہ پرائم منسٹر پاکستان نے کون سی تاریخ پڑھ لی ہے شاید انہوں نے اسی طرح جس طرح پچھلے عرصے میں کچھ عرصہ پہلے انہوں نے کوئی جغرافیہ پڑھا تھا جس میں جاپان اور جرمنی کی سرحدیں انہوں نے ملا دی تھی
Turkish president didn't utter a word about widespread human rights violations in Pakistan occupied Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan. The rights of people living here have been trampled upon by successive Pakistani regimes. While the land and resources have been plundered through tricks and intimidation, the indigenous people continue to remain deprived of their fundamental rights. The army generals who hold greater sway in Pakistani politics have treated them like slaves. Can the world ever believe a partisan monologue which was exclusively aimed at settling one's agenda and furthering it through Kashmir?
Moving on, U.S. President Donald Trump is scheduled to arrive in India on his two-day maiden visit. A high-level delegation will accompany him to discuss and deliberate upon the entire gamut of bilateral ties. Security agreements, which the U.S. has been pushing for a long time, are going to be finalized during visit. Cities that Trump will visit are being decked up to honor him a historic welcome.
Ahmedabad, the key city of Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi's home state of Gujarat, is on a beautification spree to welcome the US President Donald Trump. Roads are decked with lights and flowers to welcome the president. Trump, his wife Melania, and the delegation will be treated to rich Indian culture upon their arrival in the city. World's largest cricket stadium, Motera, is all set for an event named Namaste Trump, where Trump and Modi will jointly address the crowd. The North Indian city of Agra is also bracing up to welcome Trump, who plans to view famed monument of love, Taj Mahal, at sunset. There will be a session of extensive engagement between two sides, and they're expected to narrow down differences over tariffs and discuss US demands for greater access to India's poultry and dairy markets.
We would not like to rush into a deal, as the issues involved are complicated, and there are many decisions which actually could affect or impact the lives of millions of people on the ground, and some also with long-term economic consequences. So we don't want to create any artificial deadline.
India tightening the intellectual property rights regime would be a step towards addressing US concerns on a matter pending between the two countries for decades. India was among 10 countries placed on a priority watch list by the US Trade Representative's Office for IP violations in April 2019, according to news reports. They are also expected to shore up cooperation in counter-terrorism and intelligence gathering, as well as remove irritants in commercial relations.
Overall, we are looking at this visit to strengthen the strategic global partnership between India and the United States.
Aiming to start a long-running project, U.S. energy firm Westinghouse is expected to sign a new agreement with the state-run Nuclear Power Corporation of India for the supply of 6 nuclear reactors. The agreement will lay out timelines and the lead local constructor for the reactors to be built at Kovoda in southern India and also address lingering concerns over India's nuclear liability law. Last year, the two governments announced they were committed to the establishment of the 6 reactors. Just days before Trump's arrival, India has also cleared a $2.1 billion defense deal confirming the purchase of 24 MH-60R multi-role helicopters for the Navy.
With a population of over 1.3 billion, India is home to innumerable varieties of cultural patterns. Each state had its unique set of customs and traditions. However, the common feature that binds them all together is the Indian heritage. Today, we bring you a northeastern festival of Lungaini, a seed-sowing festival that marks the beginning of the year for the local tribe of Nagas. People come together to showcase and celebrate their culture. Take a look.
Seed-sowing festival, or Lungaini, is one of the biggest regional festivals of India, celebrated predominantly in northeastern part of the country. Over the time, its grandeur has traveled across the country and is now celebrated by tribals living in the other Indian parts as well. People with colorful bamboo headgears, women donning traditional attires with complementary jewelries, were the highlight of one such event organized in capital New Delhi.
The purpose of celebrating Rirya Panit is to promote our tradition and culture. Our tradition and culture is our identity, and identity defines who we are. We have a rich culture, we have a rich tradition, and it is our duty as a youngster to promote our culture and identity.
Organizers believe that the celebration of the festival at non-native places help promote the culture in different parts as well. Various cultural activities are showcased during the festival, such as cultural dances and folk songs. Cultural attire shows, the lighting of a fire, drum beating, traditional folk dance, and songs mark the festivities of the day. During this festival, the community seeks the blessings of the Almighty for a bumper harvest.
This kind of festival is one of the most important in our community, and I'm very blessed that I'm here today. And this brings us a community and unity and the strength of our community.
A tug of war competition between the singles and the married people was also held.
We are in the midst of another culture, and of course we adapt their culture, and with adaption also comes how we share our culture to others, and this is the kind of time for us to share our culture.
Lungaini celebrations have evolved over the years, and its celebrations, comprising a blend of history and contemporary, have been successful in connecting the youth with its roots.
Seed sowing and harvest festivals are a fundamental part of Indian culture, celebrated across the country under different names. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.